let's take a few minutes and consider the significance of a portion of America's religious history known as the Restoration Movement. Let's consider the relevance of this period of time, as well as perhaps put it in a more appropriate historical context. The Bible student might think that because the so-called Restoration Movement that occurred in the early to late 1800s, mid to late 1800s, thereabouts, that because the Restoration Movement began, obviously after the Bible was completed, the last book of the Bible, Revelation, was written at the end of the first century, that the Bible only speaks of it in general terms. It only speaks of the concept of a Restoration Movement in generalities, if at all. On the contrary, the Bible speaks frequently and with great specificity on the subject of the Restoration Movement, on the subject of Restoration and New Testament Christian Restoration. It is a mistake, then, to differentiate the ongoing process of God's people to restore original New Testament Christianity with individual salvation and restoration of a single soul. The two events, I would argue, are fundamentally the same, only the scope is different. When you have an individual, let's start there. When a lost individual, who incidentally was once in a right relationship with God, having for at one point not been a sinner, who was then safe from his eternal punishment and had not yet yielded to temptation and sinned, only later would grow and mature and be tempted to fall and become lost. When that now lost person is confronted with the truth and becomes obedient to the truth, he renounces the error of his ways and turns to God, following God's pattern of doctrine, or form of doctrine, pattern of teaching, Romans 6:17, that God provides for Christian living. When a child of God falls back into worldliness, only later to repent and turn back to God, he turns back to God and follows, once again, God's pattern for Christian living, that pattern that he had previously abandoned. The same process is at work in the so-called Restoration Movement. The difference is in perception. The Restoration Movement is often, incorrectly, I would argue, thought of as one large global process that lasted from 1800 to 1900, or somewhere in that range. I think that's unfair, and I would say it ought to be considered an ongoing, never-ending movement to save and restore as many individual souls to God, according to the New Testament pattern, as possible. We need to stop thinking of the Restoration Movement as a historical era like the Renaissance, or like the Great Depression, or like the Dark Ages, or something to that effect. Instead, it needs to be looked at, and I need to be considering myself as part of the movement to restore just one individual soul back to its maker. And then after I've restored that one soul, I go looking for another soul to restore back to its maker, and on and on. Now, my definition then of the so-called Restoration Movement is a process to bring souls back to Christ. And so that might be a bit dumbed down, that might be an oversimplification, but I think we should be treating it as a present ongoing struggle to bring souls to Christ, according to the simple singular New Testament pattern. Peter told a crowd of horror-struck Hebrews in Acts chapter 2. First, he told them the harsh truth that they were guilty of the death of Jesus Christ, and that if they did nothing about it, they would be condemning their souls to eternal damnation. Then he told them the good news that there was a way out of eternal damnation, that they could save their souls, Acts 2:38. From then on, Christians, starting with that day, on the day of Pentecost in Acts 2, from then on, Christians have been meeting people and trying to restore them to the relationship with God that He desired for us way back at the very beginning when man walked with God in the Garden of Eden. We need to understand restoration and put the Restoration Movement in its proper context, because that should be the business of every Christian, telling the good news of salvation and restoration to every soul that we meet. Now, with all that said as a foundation, Let's expand on that. Let's consider two things. First of all, I want us to go through the Bible and notice the reality of apostasy. I want us to notice where the Bible specifically mentions how it is possible and examples of Christians who sinned and fell away from God. Then, I want us to consider the principles of an individual apostasy, an individual falling away, on a larger scale. If one Christian can fall away, then cannot also a congregation of Christians or a collection of congregations also fall away, and even the whole world then of spiritual people fall into error and teach and practice false Christianity? If one can, a million can. So we're going to consider both of those in separate instances and then tie it back together with this concept of restoration. If one can fall away, one can be restored. If a whole world can fall away, a whole world can be restored. Doesn't mean that they will be, but one can be. A whole world can be restored. And that should be what the restoration movement is all about. The fall and restoration of one, and the fall and restoration of many. Now let's begin with the fall and restoration of one. The New Testament is littered with references to warnings, fears, rebukes, and encouragements that imply a child of God may sin and remove himself from the salvation that he has in Jesus Christ. The overall purpose of the final three quarters of the New Testament, the epistles as we call them, from Romans through Revelation, three quarters of the New Testament exist simply to tell us how to stay faithful. If it's impossible for me to fall away, what reason is there for me to read how to stay faithful if it's impossible not to avoid being faithful or to avoid not being faithful? If I can't fall away, why am I reading these books that warn me that I can and how to avoid it? Paul is explicit in his letter to the Galatian Christians, Galatians 1:6 and also Galatians 5:4. In Galatians 1:6, he says, "I marvel to his brethren in Galatia that you are so soon removed from him that has called you from the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ unto another gospel. I am amazed that you have so quickly from your conversion to Christ been removed from the grace of Christ by another gospel, to another gospel." He says in Galatians 5:4, "Christ becomes of no effect to you. Christ is worthless to you if you try to be justified by the law of Moses." He says you are fallen from grace. You want to be justified and saved by the law of Moses? Then you lose the grace you have in Jesus Christ. Now he speaks to Christians there. So if it's possible for me, a Christian, to be justified, to seek justification by the law of Moses, Paul says to do so would make me fall from grace. So certainly it's possible. Anyone who, as with the Galatians, who tries to follow a pattern of salvation different from what Jesus has laid out in the New Testament, he, according to Paul in Galatians 5:4, is in danger of falling from grace. Peter teaches something on similar grounds. 2 Peter 2:20 through 22, where Paul says of Christians who sin and go back to worldliness, "If after they have escaped, the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and they are again entangled therein, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. It had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it, to turn from the holy commandments delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them as according to the true proverb, the dog is turned back to his own vomit again, the sow is that was washed back to its wallowing in the mire." The picture that Peter paints is of a dog that vomits and goes back to eat it. How disgusting. A pig that had been wallowing in filth gets washed and cleansed, but then goes back to wallow in the filth again. How wasted was their being cleansed in the first place. And he applies that to Christians who had escaped the pollutions of the world, who had left the world and got into Christ, and were again entangled therein, had gone back into sinfulness. Peter, it doesn't just here, but the chapter, everything leading up to this text in chapter 2:20, for all of chapter 2 is basically a history lesson, teaching that a Christian may sin, and teaching how people have throughout history been disobeying God, and God has been punishing them. Why is it any different if a Christian disobeys God? and does not repent than anyone else in history. And so he gives a history lesson throughout 2 Peter 2. Angels who sinned, 2 Peter 2:4, were punished by God. The wicked world in Noah's day, 2 Peter 2:5, punished by God. The vulgar cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, 2 Peter 2:6, punished by God. False teachers throughout the world in Peter's day and beyond, 2 Peter 2:10 through 17, punished by God. And then he turns to Christians, his brethren, and he says, if you go back to the world, you're like a dog going back to its vomit, like a pig going back to the mud. And you, he says, it would be better for you never to have known righteousness than to have known it and leave it again. Why? The latter end is worse than the beginning. Why? Because I know for all eternity, having missed out on heaven, what I will be missing out on. I will have a full understanding that I had it in my grasp and I threw it away. Peter continues, or really he emphasizes his point in the text just before this, 2 Peter 2:18 and 19, of false teachers. He says, they speak great swelling words of vanity. They allure through the lust of the flesh. Allure who? Who are they tempting and drawing? Not the world. Here he says, Christians. Through much wantonness, those that were clean escape from them who live in error. While they promise them liberty, they themselves are servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same he is brought into bondage. A man is overcome from these false teachers, but by them again he is brought back into bondage. Children of God, who earlier escaped wickedness, the bondage of sin, by the cunning world, by the lies of false teachers, are entangled in it once again. Probably the most specific example, and not just speaking of it in abstract like Paul and like Peter does, but a specific individual example, would be Simon the con man from Acts chapter 8, who Philip the evangelist goes to Samaria, preaches the gospel to the Samaritans in Acts chapter 8. Among those who are converted and added to the Lord's church is a former con man, translated as sorcerer, someone who would use sleight of hand and deception to make people think that he had some great power. He obeyed the gospel. Acts 8:13, Simon himself believed and was baptized. Well, according to Jesus, Mark 16:16, that means he was saved. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Well, here is Simon, who believed and was baptized. Therefore, he was saved. Now, it's important to note the word choice by Luke, the author of Acts. He doesn't say, Simon said he believed and was baptized. It says, Simon believed. The inspired penman of the letter says, Simon obeyed the gospel. Therefore, Simon wasn't pretending. Simon wasn't faking. Simon wasn't just saying it to get by. He actually believed and obeyed the gospel. But when Simon saw, Acts 8:18, that through the laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Spirit was given, he offered them money, saying, give me also this power, that on whomsoever I lay hands he may receive the Holy Spirit. But Peter said to him, your money perish with thee. You have thought the gift of God may be purchased with money. You have neither part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent therefore of this thy wickedness, and pray to God, if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. For I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness and in the bonds of iniquity. Peter says to Simon, his brother in Christ, that you have sinned by trying to take this power that we have and use it for your own gain. And you have sinned and you are now in the bonds, the shackles of iniquity, the shackles of sin. He says this to a brother in Christ. I have heard false teachers teach this text and willfully insert a word changing the meaning. They will willfully say, you are yet in the bond of iniquity. You are still in the bond of iniquity. Well, Peter didn't say yet. Peter didn't say still, because that would imply he had never obeyed the gospel. What Peter says was, Brother Simon, you are in the shackles of sin. So repent and pray that you get out of them. If Simon is a Christian, then everyone who ever claims a Christian can't fall away is wrong. Simon is a Christian. Luke says so. Therefore, Christians can fall away. An individual may so sin as to shatter the relationship he has with Christ. As long as he stays faithful to God, not perfect, but faithful, 1 John 1:7, then he walks in the light and the blood of Jesus continually cleanses him. He never has anything to worry about. But in the case of Simon, in the case of the Galatians, in the case of the false teachers and those swept up by them that Peter wrote of, in each of those instances and more the Bible talks of, A Christian can sin and leave the fellowship he has with God by his own willful disobedience and refusal to repent. And so he puts in danger his own soul and his immortality, his eternal spirit, is in danger of hellfire forever. One soul can sin and be restored. But now consider the sin, the fall, and the restoration of many souls. The Bible teaches a collective rebellion as well. Jesus wrote to seven congregations in Asia, the book of Revelation, that if they refused to repent from their wickedness, and he lists some specific wickednesses and almost all of them, that if they refused to repent from their wickedness, that he would blow out the light of their candlestick. Now that's obviously a metaphor, but what's it a metaphor of? It has to be symbolic of something. He says, if you don't repent, if you are not faithful again, I will extinguish the light of fellowship that I have with you. I'll remove the candlestick from its place. Revelation 2:5, except you repent. Just like one individual can sin and leave fellowship with Christ, a congregation of individuals can sin and leave fellowship with Christ. Paul alludes to that in his 1 Corinthian letter, 1 Corinthians 5:7 through 11, when he deals with a brother in the church at Corinth who had sinned by having an affair with his stepmother, and who had committed this sin so egregiously, so shamelessly, and without any desire to repent and undo that sin. And the congregation had rallied around him. Instead of approaching him, trying to get him to repent, they have circled the wagons and told everyone to leave them alone. Our brother can do whatever he wants. And in doing so, by wrapping their arms of fellowship around this now sinful brother, Paul says, you put your entire relationship with God in jeopardy. And he uses the illustration of yeast. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. So purge out the old leaven so that you can be a new lump. 1 Corinthians 5:7 through 11. The meaning is, one unrepentant brother who has sinned and won't repent, in a congregation that rallies around him, the entire congregation becomes in jeopardy. So if an individual can rebel and be out of fellowship with God, a congregation can rebel and be out of fellowship with God. Could not also a plurality of congregations rebel and be out of fellowship with God? It's not just a hypothetical question, it's a historical precedent. It happened in history. Paul told the congregation at Thessalonica that the Lord would not return until there came a falling away first, 2 Thessalonians 2:3. He provides details about that falling away in 2 Thessalonians 2:3 and 4. Let no man deceive you by any means, for the day shall not come, that is, Jesus won't return, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called, or that is worshipped, so that as God sits in the temple of God, he shows himself that he is God. So that he, like God sits in the temple of God, he shows himself that he is God. Who is this man of sin that Paul says will reveal himself? There's no argument that what Paul's saying is prophetic. It's looking to something in the future. The disagreement among those in the religious community is, has this man of sin already been revealed, or has he yet to be revealed? If this prophecy has already been fulfilled, then history should have some record. Secular history, that is. Not Bible record that ends in Revelation, but the history that continued on after it. History should have some record of the New Testament church leaving the apostles' doctrine and turning to heretical teaching, like Paul describes. Does it? Paul would warn Timothy of a future time when Christians would depart from the faith. 1 Timothy 4:1 through 3. The Spirit speaks expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, commanding to abstain from meats, which God has created to be received with thanksgiving, of them which believe and know the truth. Again, there seems very little argument to be made that Paul is not speaking of the same event in Thessalonians and to Timothy. He's speaking of the same thing, he just provides more detail in one or the other. With the Thessalonian text, same with the Timothy text, this is prophetic words. He speaks of latter times. He doesn't get specific, though, in telling us when exactly these latter times will take place. The Protestants in the Reformation movement argued that Paul was prophesying the rise of the Roman Catholic Church. The Roman Catholic Church likewise argued that the reformers were the sinful heretics that would come later. The reformers would say that Paul was talking about the Pope when he described the man of sin who sits on the throne acting like he's God. The Catholics would say it's the various denominations who flippantly change the Word of God to suit their own ends. They're the ones trying to make themselves up as God. So both sides are pointing at the other, saying they're both what Paul was prophesying about. It could be the case, though, that both are right. And in fact, what Paul's actually talking about also predates both the Roman Catholic Church, which was started in the 600s, and the denominations that sprang out from it, from the Protestant movement. Let's back up. Let's consider some context. The New Testament church, as written of in the Bible, is a divine institution that existed before the world even began. It existed originally in the mind of God, Ephesians 3:9 through 11. To make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now unto principalities and powers in heavenly places might be made known by the church the manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose, which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, the church, the divine spiritual institution, the body of saved people, was in the mind of Jesus Christ, the mind of God, that is, according to the eternal plan of God that always culminated in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. God's eternal purpose was always the salvation of mankind, since God knew before the world was created that man whom he would create would sin against him, and that man in so sinning against him would lose fellowship that he has with God, and thus God would have to create a place. Number one, he would have to create a place to separate man from him eternally if man is not redeemed, and number two, devise a plan to redeem man should man want to be redeemed. If man doesn't want to be redeemed, then they'll go to the place prepared for the devil and his angels. Matthew 25, Jesus speaks of hell. If man wants to be redeemed, if man wants to receive the gracious salvation offered, that is freely offered but could be freely rejected, then they can go to the place that is the home of God, the dwelling place of the great eternal spirit, God the Father. For those that want to obey, God had in mind an institution, not a physical building, a spiritual institution. Really, it's a state of mind that God can look at an individual differently than another individual. He looks at one who sinned and is saved by the grace of Christ as though he had never sinned. Justified. Justified, never sinned. He can look at me as though I had never sinned. Different from those he looks at who refused the salvation of Christ. He looks at them as those who had sinned, because they have. All have sinned, Romans 3. But he can look at the saved person as though he had never sinned. And that state of mind is the church. It's the institution, the body, the collection of saved people. Throughout the Old Testament, God told the people, not just Israel, but the whole world, that this spiritual kingdom, with Christ as king and reigning over it, this spiritual body was coming. He told Judah, Isaiah did, told Judah, who was about to be forced away from physical Jerusalem to Babylonian captivity, that God's spiritual house, called a mountain in the text, would soon be established. Isaiah 2, 2 through 3. It shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the top of the mountains, shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations will flow to it. And many people shall go and say, come ye, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. And he will teach us his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law, and the word of the Lord out of Jerusalem. From Jerusalem will spring forth salvation. Daniel, in Babylon, would interpret the dream of King Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel chapter 2, of a great statue, with a golden head, with chest and arms of silver, with a torso and thighs of brass, with legs and feet of iron, and clay and iron mingled. Furthermore, David, in looking at that statue, would see also a great mountain with a stone cut out of the mountain, cut without hands, that is to say, it's of divine origin, that would strike the statue at its feet, and the statue would crumble, leaving only that stone left to be its own great kingdom, a new kingdom, a greater one. Now, modern religions take the prophecy of Daniel and they have twisted it, they have contorted it, they've made it to teach whatever they want it to teach, and they have tried to apply the meaning of that prophecy of the statue and the different elements as some great future event that will come who knows how much later in our future. But Daniel, when he makes the prophecy and he interprets the dream of Nebuchadnezzar, he localizes it immediately. He says, Nebuchadnezzar, you are the golden head, Daniel 2:38. And then he says, after thee shall arise another kingdom. So automatically he establishes a time frame of one kingdom following another kingdom. After the Babylonian kingdom, which is the golden head, would come that which is symbolized by the silver, or the kingdom that followed the Babylonian Empire, the Medo-Persian Empire, which was followed by the Macedonian or the Grecian Empire, which was followed by the Roman Empire. And so if you're following the elements with history's record of kingdoms toppling other kingdoms, you have the golden head of Babylon, you have the silver torso and chest, or rather chest and arms of the Medo-Persian Empire, you have the torso and thighs of brass of the Macedonian Empire, and you have the feet of iron and clay and the legs of iron and clay of the Roman Empire, and he says in the days of those kings. So whatever Daniel's talking about is going to take place in the days of the Roman Empire, not some great future event, but 2,000 years ago under the Roman Empire would God set up his kingdom, which should never be destroyed. The most important text of that study for our purposes is of the stone cut out of a mountain, which represents the great kingdom that would never be destroyed, Daniel 2:44. Chapter 2 of Isaiah tells us the what of his kingdom. It is the mountain of the Lord's house. Chapter 2 of Daniel tells us the when of this kingdom. It will come in the days of the Roman Empire. Chapter 2 of the prophet Daniel, or rather the prophet Joel, tells us the how of this kingdom. This kingdom will come with great miracles from on high, confirming it as a divine institution. Joel 2:28-32. It shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and handmaidens in those days I'll pour out of my spirit. And I will show wonders in the heavens and in earth, blood, fire, pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness, the moon to blood, before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall come deliverance, as the Lord has said, and the remnant whom the Lord shall call. In Jerusalem, according to Isaiah, in the days of the Roman Empire, according to Daniel, will come an outpouring of miracles from the Holy Spirit, according to Joel. You can take those three prophecies and you can trace them immediately back to Acts chapter 2. 2,000 years ago, after Jesus died, buried, and rose again and left his apostles in charge, he said, wait in Jerusalem when you will be endued with power from on high. And there they were in Jerusalem, Acts chapter 2, when power came upon the apostles, which gathered a crowd together, and they taught them the gospel, and salvation came to those that called upon the name of the Lord. And Peter, in the sermon of Acts 2, quotes from Joel, leaving no doubt that Joel was speaking of that exact moment. This is that which was spoken of the prophet Joel, Acts chapter 2, 16-21. And so those that obeyed the gospel, those that repented and were baptized, Acts 2:38, were added to the Lord's church by the Lord, the King of the kingdom, Acts 2:47. God, the eternally holy being, looking at a sea of humanity of sinful people, had to devise a way in which they could be looked at as though they were not sinful. And so that's the church. That's the body of saved people, separated from darkness, placed into the light of Jesus Christ, 1 Peter 2:9. Which goes back to his need by nature to have fellowship only with holy beings. God cannot have fellowship with sinful beings. He has to separate. So that's the church. It's a spiritual institution composed of saved people. It is not a building. The church is not a temple. It's not a building with a steeple. It's not a temple in Rome. It's not a religious club that you join after being voted on by members. It is simply what a person is a part of if a person is saved. And it's clear in reading the New Testament that it is built by Jesus, Matthew 16:18, and that there is only one of them, Ephesians 1, Ephesians 1, 22 and 23, and also Ephesians 4, 4 through 6. These saved people of the first century and who lived and practiced and followed apostolic doctrine, who had the apostles there to tell them exactly how to worship and what pattern of teaching to follow, did not have, though they had the apostles in the flesh, though they had letters as they were being written, did not have, throughout the first century, the completed full revelation of God. It was still being written, and the letters were still being delivered. By the end of the first century, revelation was completed. Both the book and the concept, all of revelation, had been done. And then, at the end of the first century, you have the apostles pretty much all having now died out, John being the last one. And the church is now left, that God's people on earth are now left with a bound collection of holy writings to guide them, for them to follow, to know how to be faithful, how to stay faithful, how to practice worship as they're supposed to. But like children, when parents are away, with the apostles gone, false teaching began to creep in, starting immediately in the second century. And you can go to secular history of writers who wrote of the church, its existence, and some additions made here, an addition made there, a subtraction, someone taking out something they didn't like, a teaching that took over and became widespread, though it was separate and removed from the Word of God. Eventually, the church became influenced by Greek philosophy, by Judaism, by paganism, and the makeup of what made a congregation of God's people a congregation of God's people began to be changed until eventually it was unrecognizable to apostolic pattern, to the Word of God. In the second century, immediately after John's death and the apostles had died out, congregations were changing what it meant to be a congregation, whereas the New Testament speaks clearly of overseers, a plurality of men overseeing the general affairs of a congregation, following the Word of God. Shepherds, they're sometimes called pastors, they're sometimes called bishops, they're sometimes called, always spoken of in the plurality, always spoken of as overseers following the Word of God. As early as the second century, changes began to be made to that pattern. What would happen, according to history, is the collection of pastors, shepherds, overseers, the presbytery, as it's sometimes called, would elect one individual of them to be the ruler of the entire congregation. They would call him the bishop of the presbytery. And so this bishop was now a singular voice of authority, instead of, according to the New Testament pattern, just one of a plurality in the voice of authority. But now you have one man running, a group of elders overseeing a congregation. Eventually, you had that one bishop being evangelistically minded, wanting to establish congregations in regions and towns around him. And he would do so. And Christians would begin to meet and gather in towns all around. And they would be overseen by a presbytery. They'd be overseen by shepherds, pastors. But that one bishop would remain in authority over now multiple congregations, despite the fact the New Testament speaks clearly of individual congregations of Christ being autonomous. You can't tell us what to do. We can't tell you what to do. We all follow the Bible, our own. But, you know, if we want to start at 10 o'clock on Sunday and you want to start at 11, we're not going to boss you around. You know, that sort of thing. They're all autonomous. But this one bishop now has established three or four different congregations, and they're not autonomous. They're following his one guide. And eventually this pyramid begins to form with one man overseeing dozens of congregations, until eventually you have in Rome and you have in Egypt, you have in Constantinople, three distinct regions of congregations being followed by three singular bishops, until eventually you have basically three men running the entire Christian world, and a complete departure from the New Testament pattern. In the 4th century, Christianity was legalized under the Roman Empire, under Roman law. It became a state-sanctioned religion. It was promoted as the state religion. The emperor in the 4th century called a council of bishops together in Nicaea of Bithynia. Now, at this point in history, the individual bishops were the top of the food chain. There were several, they were equal, but they had their own diocese, they had their own regions that they were teaching and they were overseeing, but there was nothing higher than a bishop. At this council, it was decided that they needed a universal bishop to oversee all of the bishops. Now, mind you, this is the 4th century, but if you look back in history, in the 2nd century, around 190, AD 190, Victor, who was Bishop of Rome, decided to jump the gun and say he would be the universal bishop over all the churches, that he'd be the universal head. The word universal in Latin, by the way, is Catholicos, or Catholic. So this one bishop, Victor, in 190 AD, decided he was going to run the church. Everybody pretty much ignored him. But 3 centuries later, in the 4th century, you have these bishops gathered together, and Antioch, Rome, and Alexandria, Egypt, Constantinople, and Rome, gathered together. The key bishops of their respective areas were looked at as the 3 heads of the church, and over time, Christians, and more importantly, bishops, began to look to the Bishop of Rome as the central voice of authority. And that makes sense. The Roman Empire was the key empire of the day. It was the world empire. And so people were used to looking to Rome for answers. Well, all the bishops had taken to look to the Roman bishop for authority. And they began calling him their father. They began calling him their spiritual father, or papa, or pope. Ironically, in the 2nd century, I mentioned Victor in 190, but he was one of the last bishops to begin a monarchical reign over a presbytery. That practice that started of elders appointing one bishop over them had taken over the Christian world, but Rome was one of the last ones to adopt that. And now here, ironically, the Roman bishop is the one being looked at by bishops all over the world as the Papa, as the Pope. Now, it is March 5th, 2013. As we speak, the Roman Catholic Church in existence today is preparing to elect a new Pope. Benedict XVI, I think his name is, stepped down. First time in 600 years or so that a Pope has stepped down, and now they're preparing to elect a new Pope. They will treat this person, whoever this new Pope is, as the head of the church. They'll call him the head of the church of Jesus Christ, whose every decree, they say, will be infallible, and so on. And I don't mean to be insulting to any Catholic. I have Catholic friends. But if we were just to look through history, starting with the New Testament history, as record shows, go through secular history from the 2nd century on, it's very clear what the Roman Catholic Church is in its proper historical context. It is that which formed slowly and deliberately based on piece by piece dismantling of the authority of the Word of God. The Word of God, which speaks of one congregation having elders, from there they added a bishop over the elders, then bishops over one bishop over congregations, then one bishop over the bishops. And that great pyramid became what we see now is still in existence as the Roman Catholic Church, because they began following Romanism. They began following the Roman Church. And they treated his word, the Roman bishop, as universal law or Catholic law. And so comes into existence the Roman Catholic Church in about 606 or so, 630, 600s A.D. If the solution for one Christian who falls away into error is to be restored, if the solution for one congregation that falls away into error is to be restored, then the solution for a world of congregations who over the course of centuries has fallen into error is the same. The solution is to be restored. And so when you have the Roman Catholic Church at the height of its power, Reform heroes like Wycliffe and Martin Luther and John Calvin, John Wycliffe, Martin Luther, John Calvin, they all tried, looking at the corruption of the Roman Church, they all tried to reform the Catholic Church to be more Bible-based. They all failed. Though their efforts were admirable, their efforts were, they have to be considered failures, because they never thought to go beyond the Roman Catholic Church. They failed because their efforts never extended beyond fixing the inherently broken Roman Catholic institution. The Catholic Church itself is a departure from the Bible, from the faith. And so the great reforms that those reformers and the Reformation movement tried to bring about, all they did was make things worse. Because from the efforts of the reformers like Luther and Calvin and others came the various denominations. The word which just means a part of a whole, a denomination, a part of a whole. The Catholic Church looks at the Baptist Church, the Methodist Church, the Pentecostal Church as parts of, offshoots from the larger whole. And historically, that's exactly what they are. Men started the Baptist Church because they saw a need to change what was wrong with the Catholic Church. They didn't think to go back to the Bible. They said, let's just tweak it. Let's just put lipstick on the pig. No one ever looked beyond the Roman Catholic Church, probably because the Catholic Church was too big. Its place in history was too vast over too long a period of time. History itself, still written by Catholic historians, for someone to conceive the radical notion that there was something that existed before the Catholic Church. And so you have these various religious denominations that exist today, hundreds, with new ones starting every day, all of which originally sprang from desire to reform the Roman Church. All exist, they say, in relative harmony with one another, despite the fact that they all teach fundamentally different things, that they have different hierarchies, they answer to different governing bodies, they hold to different creeds. Any unbiased individual can look at denominational Christianity and say it doesn't pass the smell test. Its entire existence is a self-contradiction. The only way to accept denominational Christianity as okay is to ignore the fact that God wants His worshipers to worship Him with unity. That God expects believers to be united and to think the same thing, to follow the same pattern, to do the same things. You have to ignore that God wants that in order to accept denominational Christianity and the Roman Catholic institution. So for all the great noble intentions of the reformers, and more often than not, it was noble. They wanted to fix what they saw was broken. They never fixed it. They just started something else that was broken as well. It would take hundreds of years from the time of the Reformation before a new generation of Bible thinkers would emerge. Men who are fueled not only by the corruption of the Roman Mother Church, but by the confusion that sprang from denominational Christianity, so-called. These men would, largely independent from one another, advocate a different kind of religious revival. Not a reformation, not reforming, tweaking an inherently flawed system, but a soul-by-soul restoration of the original, pure, simple New Testament Christianity. One that speaks of a church that existed long before the Roman Catholic Church, with all of its traditions, with all of its flourish and spectacular splendor and majesty and all of the spectacle, the Roman Catholic Church, originally before all of that, was a simple Bible-based New Testament Christianity. And these Bible thinkers, starting around the 1800s, said, let's go back to that. We can go back to that. We need to go back to that. And so you have men like James O'Kelly, who was an Episcopal turned Methodist from Virginia, who was a disillusioned denominationalist and gathered with fellow disillusioned denominationalists and began to teach that the Bible only was good enough, that the name Christian only was sufficient enough. And other men around the country, separate from each other, started having similar epiphanies. There was Abner Jones, a Baptist preacher around the New England area, who said, why don't we just call ourselves Christians? Why don't we abandon this whole denominational thing? 1,000 miles south, there's a Presbyterian preacher with ties to many faiths, Anglican, Baptist, Methodist, Episcopal, named Barton W. Stone, who was hosting a revival for the Presbyterian Church in Cane Ridge, Kentucky. A gathering at the time that was assisted by local area denominational preachers like him of the Baptist and Methodist faith. This event was a great success. The great success of the event sparked in Barton Stone a desire to do more with his fellow preachers that happened to be of other denominations. He wanted them to work together, to be more united, as, you know, that fellow Jesus said we should be. But he found very quickly that his plans were dead on arrival, because There's too many differences between Baptist and Methodist, between Methodist and Episcopal, between Episcopal and Presbyterian. They couldn't all get along. They couldn't all agree. And so he became very disillusioned. And he said, well, why don't we just do what the Bible says? And if Presbyterian church disagrees with it, well, we shouldn't do it. If the Baptist church disagrees with it, well, we shouldn't be doing it. We should just be doing what the Bible says. So he formed a presbytery in Springfield, Kentucky, and began meeting there with fellow like thinkers regularly. Now, it's at this point in history, we're about the early 1800s, that men like O'Kelly and Haggard and Jones and Stone seem very reform-minded. And they probably were. That's the only historical precedent that they had. And like many of these reformers, their efforts usually resulted in the establishment of a new religious body. But in the case of Cane Ridge, the presbytery that gathered there realized very quickly that they were falling into the same trap, that they themselves were starting a new denomination. And so less than a year after the forming of the Springfield Presbytery, they realized the error of their ways, and they said, we need to disband and not be a presbytery anymore. Before they did so, they took the unusual step of drafting a last will and testament. As though they were about to euthanize this institution, they said, before we kill it, let's give it a last will and testament. And in this last will and testament, which I have hanging on my office, on my office wall, they claim a desire to dissolve this body and become a part of the body of Christ at large. To be a part of the Church of Christ, lowercase c, church, the spiritual institution belonging to Christ. That they should all maintain autonomous congregations overseen by an eldership, rejecting the top-down government approach that the Catholic Church instituted and that their denominations later had as well. And so, almost like the Declaration of Independence, they signed the Declaration of Denominational Independence. And just like with the American Revolution, they came under fire from critics who were part of denominations and who thought that they were being slandered by this last will and testament. And so they started calling these followers New Lights. They started calling them Stonites. What they did not call them, though, is Campbellite. Because it was 1807, 3 years after the Springfield Presbytery was euthanized, that another preacher came ashore to the United States of America, a Presbyterian Irishman named Thomas Campbell, who landed in America, settled in Pennsylvania, and began preaching in Pittsburgh. And the more he studied his Bible, the more he would preach only his Bible, which drew fire and ire from his Presbyterian leadership. They accused him of being a false teacher, which, to be fair, he was, as a Presbyterian, because he was teaching just the Bible. And so he left the Presbyterian Church soon after and began preaching and advocating an undenominational Christianity. His aim was never to establish a new church. He had no intention of fixing the Presbyterian or any other denomination. His goal was to reach back to the pages of the New Testament, predating denominations, predating the Roman Catholic Church, and restore a kind of pure New Testament Christianity that the apostles oversaw in the first century. As he spoke, he would gather large crowds of people who saw the same corruption and confusion in the religious world. And he would appeal to them, saying, where the scriptures speak, we should speak. Where the scriptures are silent, we should be silent. It was a motto that was clear. It was reasonable in its intent, but if carried out, it would mean the end of all denominations, of all the Roman Catholic institution, of every man-made religious body. If all we're doing is speaking where the Bible speaks, if all we do is being silent where the Bible's silent, then every man-made addition that's ever been would cease to be. With the help of his son Alexander, who came to America not long after, who also, by the way, critics tried to make a leader of a church, but he himself never claimed such. He himself said, by the way, let us return to the original church as it is developed and portrayed in Scripture. With his help and with the other reform heroes that we've mentioned and others who we have no time for, because it would take the entire time to discuss them, they began, independent of one another, to preach and teach simple New Testament Christianity. Eventually, through word of mouth, through publications, periodicals, debates, what have you, they became known of one another. They began working together as best they could to help each other. And eventually, individual Christians claiming no earthly religious group, following no human creeds, just individual Bible-following Christians began to gather in congregations to teach only the New Testament pattern, to follow only the New Testament pattern. They call themselves Christians only. They claim to be members of the Church of Jesus Christ, His body of the saved, having been added to it the same way they were added to it in Acts 2:38, holding no earthly headquarters, having no governing body, just those that identify themselves as Christians only. Later came in the 1900s, preachers like Hardiman, like Nichols, Woods, who carried on the work of those pioneer era restorers, who preached one gospel for one church, each individual soul. A next generation of preachers is working today, who are taught in preaching schools all over America, all over the world, in Memphis, in Florida, in Arkansas, in Oklahoma, in Texas, in India, in Singapore, in Russia. Some are teaching themselves by just opening their Bibles, seeing the God-given Word, and teaching that there's something wrong with man-made religions, but there's something very right about this book. And because they teach just the book, they're slandered, they're accused, they're attacked. But they keep on preaching because they know if they have the Bible, then what they have is right. And they follow in the footsteps of men who went before, whose pledge is the same as it's always been, to restore in every soul the New Testament church by the New Testament pattern. Now, the nation today in the 21st century is much different than it was in the 19th century when men like Campbell and Stone and O'Kelly and John Smith were teaching. It's different than it was in the 20th century, when there were great preachers like Wendell Winkler and Gus Nichols and Guyon Woods who were teaching and preaching. America is not the same morally minded, truth-seeking people that it was back then. But there are still people who seek confusion around them and who want the simple truth. The New Testament offers that simple truth, and it is our job as Christians, it's my job as a preacher, to teach only the simple New Testament gospel to save and restore the relationship that was once there, the soul once had with God. Religion in general, though, is mocked. It is outlawed piece by piece in some circumstances. There's a philosophy that exists in the world that says, I'm okay and you're okay. We can be different as long as we stay okay. We have a very progressive culture that has made it so it's offensive to simply call out someone, to try to show someone where they might be mistaken. But there is a pattern that is right, that tells the difference between right and wrong, and it's the job of the Christian, every Christian, to lay out that pattern. The seed is the Word of God, Luke 8:11. And there will always be, as there have always been, hearts of fertile soil who desire to know God, who find frustration with the confusing world of denominationalism, who see corruption with the Roman Catholic Church, and who think there must be Christianity that's not so wrong. Those are the kinds of people who, to quote Campbell, want the old gospel back, who want to be sustained by the ancient order of things. It is those the members of Christ's church preach, that we preach to, that we beg them to follow the pattern given to us by God, to repent of the sins that keep them separated from God, in full obedience to the commandments of God, to be restored to a proper relationship with God, separate and removed from man-made barriers and capital C churches of any variety. Every time a gospel-pricked heart obeys the truth, the New Testament church is restored in Him, and He is restored in it. That's New Testament Christianity. That's what the restoration movement is. It is not a period of time in the 1800s. It is the desire of every Christian, every New Testament Christian, every Bible-believing, simple little C church member, part of the kingdom of Jesus Christ. That is His appeal. That is His desire. That is His goal, to restore souls back to its maker. That's the restoration movement in a nutshell. Thank you very much for listening.